about hope this week as well. So, anything we need to cover in prayer before we get started? I know Catherine had posted about your niece needing surgery for a cyst. Where are they at right now? What's her name again?
Stephanie.
Stephanie, right. Okay. So we'll continue to pray for Stephanie needing the surgery so she's out of pain. No good. Anything else we need to pray for? I am passing around. It's somewhere here. It's the prayer request notebook and the snack sign up. There's a couple weeks open, and we said if they don't get filled, that's okay. We're big girls. Oh, there's not a boy here today, so I don't have to say boy today. So that's fine, too. But if you want to sign up for a week, that's fine. Anything else pressing you need to pray for? The one that took the turn for the worst?
Nice.
Yeah. Turn around. Yay, wow. Jillian was telling me last night, she was FaceTiming me, that she has a, their campus is doing really well. It's like less than half of 1% has COVID, which is really good. But her worship, she's in like a worship leading class, and he and his family have been passing COVID, but he already had it. So he can't, anyways, she was just like, it's a pain because all his kids got well, and then the one that didn't get it also got it. And so he has to stay home, and he was staying home earlier because his wife, anyways, she's like, no one's really sick. It's just that it's really, really inconvenient. So, oh yeah, you had your hand.
When I moved here about 7 years ago, I started coming in the fire, and all the sick people were sick. And this little lady, Ruth, was there. And she was sick.
Oh, that's right. You're giving us an update on Ruth Plant.
Exactly right.
Oh, she did. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. No, thank you for updating us, because that was, a couple weeks ago, or last week you were telling us about that. Okay, let's pray, and then we will jump in. God, thank you for your faithfulness to this class. Thank you for the beautiful, cool weather this morning that's refreshing. Thank you that even as we are studying a book about judgment, about evil hearts, about hard things happening to a group of people, that we were able to find hope in that, and that even as we woke up this morning, the cool weather, it just reminded me of hope also, that when sometimes it seems like all is lost or things are never going to change, they do, God. And I thank you that you are a God of change and a God of refreshment and a God of redemption, and we thank you for that. I thank you that Ruth Blanche, that her journey, although it came to an end, and I know her family is heartbroken and her husband as well, as Blanche reminded us, her journey with Jesus is forever and is delightful. And we praise you that Kathy's uncle, who seemed like he was going to meet Jesus imminently, that he is actually home and with his family. And so we also lift up her niece, Stephanie, who is undergoing surgery this morning. We just pray that there's no complications, that they are able to take care of the source of her pain. God, as we work our way through Jeremiah, we thank you for being with us. Keep us in your truth. We want to be people, people of truth, people who are faithful. And thank you for this time together again. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. So, moving forward, right? I can sit down now. You just taught the lesson, right? You like make connections to today, you're done. There's your application. But it is. It's true. Yeah, you go, has anything changed? Maybe not. Okay, let's do a quick review. Let's just do fast review so we don't spend too much time on it. let's look at kind of, if you look at your at-a-glance sheet, you don't have to, but it's in the appendix. I don't know what page it is because I didn't grab it, but if you look at that, we got a text back, Amy. I don't know if it'll help you. It didn't work? Okay, that's fine. So is it what again? 209. Okay. Sometimes we can take books of the Bible and we divide them into what we call segments, where sometimes we can fit several chapters together and put them under one even bigger heading. We're kind of sort of doing that right now. I mean, you might find that. If you look at Jeremiah as we have studied it so far, chapter 1 stands on its own, I think, because Jeremiah chapter 1 is who is talking to who. Right, so we have Jeremiah's call. So it stands on its own. It's a message from God specifically to Jeremiah saying, I'm calling you to be a prophet. Yes, I know you're young, but you can still do it. I will be with you. No, people won't like your message. They're going to come against you, but I will be with you. And God tells them the content of your message is what? You need to turn back to him. My people have forsaken me. So that's Jeremiah chapter 1. Now, when you go to Jeremiah chapter 2, one could say that we start a new segment, and it's Jeremiah 2, and it goes all the way to 3, verse 5. And the way you can think of it, it is the message, right? And in Jeremiah 2, who is this message to? Do we know? Jeremiah 2. Yeah, so it says proclaim to Jerusalem, and again, what's the overall message? Okay, again, right? You have forsaken me. So, we don't know, we're not told, like when in time. We do know that Jeremiah, he prophesies starting in whose reign? Josiah's reign, and he ends in whose reign? Zedekiah, yeah, the last king of Judah when they are finally completely overtaken, right? Okay, so during those reigns, okay, we're not told during whose
reign this message was given. We don't know. Okay, I like to read things and assume they're chronological, but we're not told for sure, so I don't want to mislead you. Okay, then Jeremiah 3:6 starts another message. And this one goes all the way to chapter 6, verse 30. Now, so keep there. We do get a little bit of a chronological marker here. Starting in Jeremiah 3:6, this is a message during whose reign? So 3:6 will tell you during whose reign was this message, Jeremiah 3:6. Yeah. Just really quickly, what do we remember about Josiah? The king.
He's trying to straighten things out.
He tried to straighten things out. The law was found. The law had been lost. We're not sure exactly when, but the law had
things, but even during that reign, we have Jeremiah come and deliver a message, and was Jeremiah's message, hey, good job, guys, you're fine. It wasn't, which is what's kind of surprising. What is this message? Yeah, so we have, yes, there are consequences, right? Yes, we had faithless Israel, we had treacherous Judah. Ooh, the lights are on. So faithless Israel, treacherous Judah. We've got this picture of harlotry really starts becoming developed. A lot of images about how Judah had given herself to other lovers, that she was in a covenant relationship with God, but then how she went out and she gets compared to the donkey and heat and all that fun stuff. True story. But, anyway, so we have all that. Now, so since they've been faithless, Since they've committed harlotry, we know that God's going to judge them. Do we know what that judgment's going to look like? What's it going to look like? Taken over by who? Well, Assyria took over Israel, and Babylon's going to take over Judah. So I'm just going to say the enemy from the north is going to come, and he's going to take over them. So that takes us all the way to today. Look at that. Jeremiah 7. Y'all go to Jeremiah 7.
Jeremiah 7. I am actually going to read these first 11 verses, mostly because they're short, but I do want, I think it just helps us to get the language and get everything under our belt. And so we're going to be
listening for what is God telling Jeremiah to do? Is this a new message? If it is, like, where, when is he delivering it, and all that fun stuff. So I'll read verses 1 to 11 just to make sure we all hear it and we're all together. So, 7 verse 1. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word, and say, hear the word of the Lord, all you of Judah, who enter by these gates to worship the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your deeds, and I will let you dwell in this place. Do not trust in deceptive words, saying, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. I want to make that a song. This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. For if you truly amend your ways and your deeds, if you truly practice justice between a man and his neighbor, if you do not oppress the alien, the orphan, or the widow, and you do not shed innocent blood in this place, nor walk after other gods to your own ruin, then I will let you dwell in this place, in the land that I gave to your fathers forever and ever. Behold, you are trusting in deceptive words to no avail. Will you steal, murder, and commit adultery, and swear falsely, and offer sacrifices to Baal, and walk after other gods that you have not known? Then come and stand before me in this place, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered, that you may do all these abominations. Has this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your sight? Behold, I, even I, have seen it, declares the Lord. That was a lot of information. But starting here in Jeremiah chapter 7, do you all think a new message is starting? Does it sound like the beginning of a new message? It's getting more personal. I mean, is it a continuation of this one, or do you think it's a new one? So the content is similar. It's detailed. Let's go back to verse 1 and then look at verse 2. Thank you. So where is Jeremiah supposed to deliver this? Have we heard that with any of these other messages? No. So it seems like even though the content is very similar, I would say this is a new message. Because we're told, go stand in a very specific place, Jeremiah, and declare some very specific things. Who is he speaking to in his message? Who's he delivering the message to? All the people coming into worship. So how would you guys like on Sunday morning, right? One of the members on our church, as you were walking in, is like, I need to tell you how horrible you are. We would be like, 911, send some help, right? Well, you wouldn't enter. You'd be like, oh, I'm not going in there this morning, right? But so Jeremiah is sent to stand at the entrance to the temple. So this message, why do you think he's sent to the temple? Like, what's he supposed to say? No, he's not talking to the Pharisees. So what's he saying? Verse 3, change your ways. What's wrong with their ways? Would they forget? They forgot what again, Rachel? They forgot how to be God's people. You said what, Nivea? They're worshiping without a beat. Ooh, I like this. They forgot how to be God's people. Being God's people means you worship and you are obedient. What else did someone else say? Right. Right. So the standard operating procedure of the temple was not right, and they'd become used to it. So let's remind ourselves too, what's the temple for? What's it about there? What are they doing? It's worship. Worshiping who? God. They actually believed that God's presence was there. Let's remind ourselves too, who built this particular temple? Solomon. That's important, I think. Solomon's beautiful temple. The people went there to worship. It's in the capital city. So this is like, not only staying in front of church, this is like going to the capital of the United States if we had a head church place. That's kind of where they're at. So the place where they believe they meet God, and he's saying, amend your ways. You've forgotten how to be my people. You aren't obeying me when you worship. And he has an if-then statement, right? There's a couple of them. The first if-then, I think, starts in verse 5. If you do what? Yeah, not just if you say you're sorry. If you amend your ways, to me that says if you change what you're doing, and then he lists some other ifs, right? If you amend your ways, and then he lists...
If you do what? What are some of those things?
Practice
justice. If you want to do what else?
Do not oppress.
That's part of that, I guess. What else? If you practice justice, if you do not oppress one another, if you...
walk after God.
Yeah. Okay, so, and some other things, right? Ooh, if you do not murder, I think... Okay, so he says, if you amend your ways, truly, I love the truly, I left that out there. If you truly amend your ways, it's going to look like this, right? You're going to look like this. Then, what's the promise? Then God says,
then I'll meet you up here.
Do you think he meant in Judah, or do you think he was specifically referring to the temple? I heard a yes.
I agree, but I do think there is a special focus on the temple here. So I think this is Jeremiah's message regarding the temple. Maybe I'll just say it like this. At the temple...
I wish we could lower this board. Me too. Jeremiah, so this is Jeremiah's message at the temple. So, okay, there's an if-then statement. Okay, we got what amending would look like.
I want to go to 3. And I want to look at 3 one more time. He said, amend your ways and deeds, and I will let you dwell in this place. I marked this place as the temple. I marked this place just like I marked the temple in verse 2, because he says, Jeremiah, go stand, in verse 2, he says, go stand in the gate of the Lord's house, proclaim there. If you amend your words and deeds, I will let you dwell in this place. And then verse 4, do not trust saying, this is. I think all the this's are focusing on the temple. So I do think there's a special focus on the temple. And so when you go down there to verse 4, he says, hey, listen, you people are speaking deceptive words, or you're trusting deceptive words. And in verse 4, what are those deceptive words? It's that song. What are they saying when they're stating that? God is saying those are deceptive words right now. When the people are saying, this is the temple, look at Solomon's beautiful temple. I'm walking into the temple, I'm taking my things. I mean, I imagine that's what they're saying. And he says, right now, those are deceptive words. Yeah, you guys aren't treating this place correctly. It's superficial faith. He's like, I think he's also saying their faith is in that temple. their faith is that the temple's always going to be there. And that's why I had us remind ourselves that they believe the temple was God's dwelling with them. Why did they think he would never let his temple be destroyed? I mean, it's so pretty, yes. I think there's other reasons, though. What other reasons? He's there. And these are his people. So in their mind, to your point, Gina, they're like, God can't destroy this temple. This is where he is. Yeah. And it's gorgeous and it's beautiful and everyone comes and it's been standing for years and years and years. God will never destroy it. So it's like he's saying they're putting their faith in that temple. And that because that temple was standing, God was actually happy with them. Remember the other deceptive words are the other prophets saying, peace, peace. God's not going to punish us. And they could look at the temple and go, you're right, because the temple's still there. We're not going to get punished. I think that's part of what he is addressing with them. I think that's why we see Jeremiah go to the temple to deliver this message. Let's go, what else do we need to hit? We hit six. If you will not oppress the alien, if you don't walk after other gods, I'll let you dwell in this place and in the land. So yes, he does expand the scope, and in the land I gave to you. Verse 8, you're trusting in deceptive words. Look at that twice. First in verse 4, and now in verse 8, he's saying, the words you're putting your faith in are actually deceptive. And that hurts me to say that, because I have to say, are there deceptive words that the church today proclaims that people have faith in that sound like God would never do this to us because, I don't know, we're gonna keep thinking on those things. Okay. So we have to ask ourselves, go to Micah 6:8, let's do a quick review, and let's go, what does please God? You know, if you've read Jeremiah now seven chapters in, you know clearly what does not please him. But Micah 6:8, let's review what does please God. And then we'll bring it back to what we just read. Micah 6:8 says, he has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do what? Justice, to love what? Kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Micah 6:8. He's told you, O man, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you. Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with your God. What pleases God? What pleases God? God pleased by what's going on in that temple? Are those things going on in the temple? It appears not. To your point, Rachel, and outside the doors, yes, that counts too, right? Outside the doors also counts. So you also can't clean it up and come to the temple and say, I'm taking care of the orphans, the widows, I'm kind, I'm loving, and go out home and be ugly. You can't treat your family horribly, come to church and present this cleaned up pretty version and assume that that's okay. God sees it all, right? Okay, so going back to Jeremiah 7:11, 7:11, he's saying, you know, back up to verse 9, he's saying, well, you do all these evils and then come back to my temple and say, we're delivered with faith because this still stands, right? He says, as this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your sight, behold, I have seen it. What had they made the Lord's house into? What does Jeremiah call it? Does that remind you of anybody else? I had no idea. I don't know why I had no idea. When did Jesus say those words? So what is similar? So then we go, okay, if Jesus quoted Jeremiah 7:11, we go, okay, what was similar in both time periods? Right. And what is the wrong, I mean, yes, let's just hammer it in. What is the wrong way to use his temple? Selfing, okay. For personal gain. I like that. We've seen some verses in Jeremiah where they're like, you don't uphold the orphan and the widow because you want personal profit. So we know that's going on. So if you're using his house as a place of personal gain, that's wrong. What else? Worship him. I love K. Arthur's word, syncretism. So they were taking idol worship and the worship of God or Yahweh, and they were blending them and doing, that was true, in the same house. It was a place of social, place to be seen, letting their guard down. Let's keep looking through, and we're going to keep thinking on it. Let me make sure we didn't miss what I wanted to hit. Nope, we haven't hit it yet. Okay, we will eventually. Okay, verses 12 to 15. Let's look, because we're not done with this message. He is just ramping up. Yes, here we're going to bring it in. Okay, verses 12 to 15. He says, now go to my place which was in Shiloh, where I made my name dwell at first. See what I did to it because of the wickedness of my people Israel. And now because you have done all these things, declares the Lord, and I spoke to you, rising up early and speaking, but you did not hear, and I called you, but you did not answer. Therefore, I will do to the house which is called by my name, in which you trust, and to the place which I gave to you and your fathers, as I did to Shiloh. I will cast you out of my sight, as I have cast out all your brothers, all the offspring of Ephraim. Okay. What location's mentioned? Shiloh. Where is Shiloh? Well, but it's over there. It's over, right? Okay. When they came back, when the Israelites came to the promised land, and remember, all while they traveled in the desert, they had the movable temple called the tabernacle, right? They had all the furniture pieces in it, right? They would pack it up and move it. When they got to the promised land, go to Joshua 18. We're going to walk our way through. We're not going to look at all of them that you looked at in your homework because we don't have time. And to Blanche's point, it was a long lesson. And so we're gonna kind of do the short version of this. But Joshua 18:1, this is, remember, the second generation coming out of Egypt. They've wandered in the desert for 40 years. They finally get to the promised land. Joshua 18:1. Then the whole congregation of the sons of Israel, they believe million plus, assembled themselves where? Shiloh. And they set up the tent of meeting there, and the land was subdued before them. Shiloh, by the way, was north of Jerusalem. So it's north of Jerusalem. A bit of ways away. So they landed there in the promised land. It says they set up the tent of meeting or the tabernacle. And what was done with the land at that moment? What does that mean? Peaceful, no enemy. So the conquering of the land, it was accomplished. So when God said, that's going to be your land, it became their land. Right? Peace on all corners. So they set up the tent of meeting. Now, go to Judges. We're going forward in time. When it's in the book of Judges, you know the Israelites are messing up. Sad, but true. When you get to Judges chapter 18, lots of battles, lots of people coming against Israel, Israel crying out to God, God saving them. Still, the tabernacle is at Shiloh. There's not been a a permanent structure has not yet been built. It's still that tabernacle. You go to Judges 18:31, it says, they set up for themselves Micah's graven image, which he had made all the time that the house of God was at Shiloh. I know just one little verse, but what did you gather from that verse when you read it? What's going on? Idols, graven images. And it's telling you that idol came where? It was established there at Shiloh. I went back and read through the chapter, but basically what they're doing is they're beginning to bring idols into the tabernacle when it was at Shiloh. Okay. Mm-hmm. Micah made the idol. Micah is a person. No, it's not an image of Micah. It's an image that Micah made. And his family, yes. Yeah. This is a moment of they're going to do it. It's syncretism. It's, you know, if God is good and the tabernacle's good, well, it's also good to bring in these idols. I think that's what they believe to some extent. Okay. Now, we're not going to go there, but you guys read it when you did your homework. You went into 1 Samuel. And in 1 Samuel, Israel is fighting the Philistines. The tabernacle is still at Shiloh. They were losing to the Philistines. And those of you that read 1 Samuel, and it was in chapter 1 and then chapter 4, what did Israel do to try to win the battle? Do you remember? They went into the tabernacle and they brought something out. The Ark of the Covenant. What was the Ark of the Covenant? Literally God's presence. So the Israelites, kind of like Lindy just made mention, they're like, we're in trouble. I know. Let's take God's presence with us into battle. So they went, and Eli, by the way, I mean, some of you that know the story about Eli and Samuel, Eli was the high priest, but his sons weren't very good priests. But Eli let them, they came in, they're like, hey, Eli, we're taking the ark. And he's like, oh, that makes me nervous, but go ahead. So they took it. What happened as a result of that battle? What happened to the ark? It got captured. It was captured, and Eli died, and his sons were killed in battle, and Shiloh took a really hard hit. If you go to 1 Samuel 4, if you want to peek, if you go to the end of that, 1 and 2 Samuel, then 1 and 2 Kings, it's 1 Samuel 4, verse 22. I'm going to make sure I get right what exactly happened there at the land. So if you go to 1 Samuel 4, 22, it was a prophetess said, the glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God was taken. All right, so that's Shiloh. Now go to Psalm, and David, the psalmist, records for us some history also about Shiloh. If you go to Psalm 78, and looking at 54 to 60, he does a great job for us. He like takes it and he condenses all of Shiloh's history into 6 verses. So we're going to revisit Psalm 78, starting in verse 54, and then we'll bring it back to Jeremiah, and we're going to compare information. So Psalm 78, 54 says, he, God, brought them to his holy land, to this hill country, which his right hand had gained. He also drove the nations out before him. Remember, we read that the land was subdued before them. He apportioned them for an inheritance by measurement and made the tribes of Israel dwell in their tents. Yet they tempted and rebelled against the Most High God and did not keep his testimonies, but turned back and acted treacherously. Ooh, there's that word treacherous again. Like their fathers, they turned aside like a treacherous bow, for they provoked him with their high places and aroused his jealousy with their graven images. When God heard, he was filled with wrath and greatly abhorred Israel, so that he abandoned the dwelling place at Shiloh, the tent which he had pitched among them. Yeah. So, in a nutshell, when God there in Jeremiah 7 has Jeremiah go stand outside the temple, and as people are coming in, can you hear Jeremiah declaring, hey guys, remember what happened at Shiloh? God wants you to remember. God wants you to consider what happened at Shiloh. What was God hoping that the Israelites would remember? did destroy it. He allowed it to be destroyed. So he's saying, Israel, you assume that because this is my house, I'm never going to let it be destroyed or overtaken. But you're forgetting about Shiloh, where I not only let the ark be taken, I eventually, that land where the tabernacle stood was utterly destroyed and abandoned. He's like, so don't put your faith in this temple and think that all is well because this beautiful temple stands. I can let that be destroyed. And he does. And he does. Hard lesson for them, right? So, in their defense, I do want to show you this. And you saw it in your homework. Go to 2 Chronicles, right? 2 Chronicles 7. 2 Chronicles 7. We're not going to read it all. In verse 11, Solomon finishes, 2 Chronicles 7:11, Solomon finished the house of the Lord. The Lord appears to Solomon and says, yes, I have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. So this is when the temple was brought to Jerusalem. Solomon built it. It was gorgeous. God said, I'm going to honor you. I'm going to honor the work of your hands. This is the place where I'm going to bring myself. I'm looking at verse 13. If I shut up the heavens so there is no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, we know this verse, and my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer offered in this place. So now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there. What does it say? Uh-huh. And my eyes and my heart will be there how long? Okay. I just want to point that out. So do you understand why the Israelites maybe thought that they were safe? So my question is, did God lie? There was a condition. And I didn't read on down, but look at verse 19, same chapter, 2 Chronicles 7, 19. I'm guessing this is the part they didn't like to recite to one another, right? I'm guessing, just like every good church, they're like, let's read the good news, right? Let's focus on how, you know, good God's been, and he's blessing us and all as well. And we forget to drop down to verses like verse 19, and Nivea said conditions. Verse 19 starts with the word, but if you do what? Verse 20, first word is what? Verse 20, first word. Then, and if then. If you turn away from me, then what happens in verse 20? Uproot you from my land, which I gave to you. I love how he reminds them. You didn't earn this land. I gave it to you. I didn't earn my salvation. It was given to me. It's all grace, right? He's like, you didn't earn it. I'm giving it to you. All I ask is that you follow my ways. And it's right. He is talking about the temple and the land. It is part of a covenantal language, but you're right. I mean, he's not saying, I will abandon you forever and ever. But he is saying this place, these things that you maybe put a lot of faith in, it isn't forever. Okay, there's some if-then. Go back to Jeremiah 7. Go back to Jeremiah 7. I know. Now, we're going to change gears just a little bit. So now I think, is it clear why God has Jeremiah speaking at the temple? If you were to summarize it, what's the reason Jeremiah's at the temple? Why did God say, I need you to go to the temple? Let's try to summarize it. Why is he there? They've been disobedient. Right. But let's focus on why he's at the temple.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right. So some people believe that when Jeremiah delivered this message, probably would have been during a festival of some sort. Yes, a convocation of the people. And so I think you were on the right track, and I think that's what we've been talking about, is the Israelites have started to place their faith in the activities going on in the temple and the structure itself. Yes. Right. So the place that has brought them comfort, I like those words. So the temple and all, you know, the festivals bring them comfort and make them remember, oh, God is for us. He brought us here. He's with us. And Jeremiah is making them very uncomfortable in that space because the faith is in the wrong place. Because they're worshiping without obedience. I'm going to use your words from earlier, and I think you were right on. They are performing all the acts, but their lives don't match up. And God says, I see all that. Wait, I mean, where do you say, or verse 11, last words, I have seen it. In other words, don't think you've even hidden it. Like, I have seen it. Okay, now, drop down to 16. Okay? 16 and 19 is a little chunk, and 16 starts with this phrase, as for you, do not pray for this people. who's speaking to who? And he said, what? How'd that strike y'all? Not good. Different? Of what? Yeah. Don't plead their case. Do you find any other evidences of places where God says, I'm done, don't plead the case? It's hard. What'd I find? Hold on. I it wasn't in your lesson, but it was mentioned. Hold on, let me see what I found. Ahaha. Go to 1 John 5. Yeah, so I'm going to go a little bit. Go to 1 John 5. This could really set us off on a rabbit trail. 1 John 5. Yeah, right. There's a couple places. 1 John 5. Look at, wait, am I in 1 John or should I be in 2nd? 1 John 5, 14 to 16. Ah, okay, yes. 1 John 5, 14 to 16. Just see how this hits you, okay? So this is the confidence which we have before him, before God. If we ask anything, he hears us. That's about prayer, right? 15, we know that he hears us in whatever we ask. We know we have the request which we have asked for him. He's talking to believers. We all know that. 16, if anyone sees his brother committing a sin, not leading to death, he will ask God. God will for him give life to those who commit sin, not leading to death. There is a sin leading to death. I do not say that he should make requests for this. What do y'all think? Go back to, okay, to keep that in your brain, let's go to Jeremiah 7 and look at 16. Let's keep reading on, and then we'll see what forms for us. He says, Jeremiah, don't pray for these people. Don't lift up cry or prayer for them. Don't intercede with me. Why? Because I don't hear you. 17, do you not see what they're doing in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem? The children gather wood. Fathers kindle the fire. The women knead dough to make cakes for the queen of heaven. And they pour libations to other gods in order to spite me. Do they spite me, declares the Lord? Is it not themselves they spite to their own shame? All right, what do y'all think? Rejection of idol worship is rejection of God. Ah, thank you. I like that. Rachel said, if you didn't hear, that's a sin. And I would agree with that in 1 John 5. The only sin that leads everybody to death and eternal damnation is what? Rejecting God. Rejecting his provision for salvation. Has Judah rejected God? And they've been warned. century. Now, would God, I mean, now go back to the beginning of Jeremiah 7, there is that if-then statement. So the question is God saying he'll never forgive? Because we saw the if-then statement at the beginning of this chapter. Yeah, God sees time in the beginning from the end. And I think God is saying, God always, that is, so this is God's character. You got to remember that too. God's character is grace and justice and love and forgiveness, but also justice, and he has to judge sin. And you see God here doing both. And I think our little human minds go, because I can't do both perfectly. God can. I mean, even as a parent, there are times my kids would, you know, disobey and disobey and disobey and disobey, and I'd say, I had it, right? But I'd let them disobey 8 more times, right? Or I wouldn't show them the grace that I should, but God does both perfectly. He perfectly judges sin, but he also perfectly offers grace and forgiveness and is always open to whoever says, I repent. Rachel brought up the point, God just knows it's been a few hundred years and I'm outside of time. I know the beginning from the end, and these people aren't going to listen to Jeremiah, and they need to know there is an end point for God. Revelation exists as well, right? There's an end point at which God's like, time's up. You know, the fullness of sin is like, I'm here, and I have to judge. And I love the fact that God is perfect because he also is telling them that. He's saying, this is the fullness of time, but I'm still going to give you this message. And again, I think that is hard for, I know it's hard for me to grasp because it's God and not man, but it's, I mean, we see it here. Let's go to verse 21 to 34. We're going to finish, I think, 7 out pretty quick. So 21 to 34, we've just got another, go to 28, let's do this, because 28 kind of summarizes, I think, 21 to 34. God says, you shall say to them, this is the nation that did not obey the voice of the Lord their God or accept correction. Truth has perished and has been cut off from their mouth. What is their spiritual condition? I know we keep saying it over and over, but God says, this nation has done what? And not accepted correction, right? They sinned, but also refused to be corrected. And he says, as a result, truth. Those of you that watched Kay's video, and we talked about it a little bit, that word for truth is actually what? What's a better translation of it? Do you remember? Faithfulness. Steadfastness. So in my Bible, every time truth, and it's not everywhere, it's in Jeremiah, and it's this particular word, you could read it as faithfulness. So it's not just like an intellectual assent, because we could say truth is just like an intellectual agreement, yes, the moon is in the sky, and, you know. But this is truth plus action. This is faithfulness, and he says faithfulness is gone. And so that's kind of a summary statement here. God's reiterating it, and he wants Jeremiah. He says the people didn't listen to the prophets, and oh, by the way, Jeremiah, they're also not going to listen to you. That's kind of verse 29. They're also not going to listen to you. 30 and 31, he said, the sons of Judah have done that which is evil in my sight. They have set their detestable things in the house, which is called by my name, to defile it. They have built the high places of Topheth, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I did not command, and it did not come into my mind. Okay, when I read that, I was like, oh, that's been taken to another level. Because what is he saying is happening? First of all, what is being set up? And we also mentioned it. What's been set up in the temple? literal idols have been brought into the temple. And also he says, there is this valley not so far from Jerusalem where what is going on? Human sacrifice. Let's take another trip down memory lane. Second Kings 16. King Ahaz. Y'all had it in your lesson or page 217 if you want to see a timeline of the kings. So we're about four kings prior to Josiah, and we're at Ahaz. So this is 2 Kings 16, verses 1 to 4. Ahaz was 20 when he became king. He reigned 16 years. He did not do what was right. He walked in the way of the kings of Israel. So he's a king in Judah, so he's looking to the north, and he's doing what they did in the north. He made his son pass through the fire. Other versions say what? Does y'all, anyone have a different version? What does it mean to pass through the fire? It's a pretty way of saying sacrificed his son in the fire. Right. Okay. So lest you wonder how bad he was, according to the abominations of the nations with whom the Lord had driven out before the sons of Israel, he sacrificed and burned incense on the high places and under every green tree. Go to 2 Kings 21. Now moving forward in time. So we have Ahaz. And you have it on your sheet. So Ahaz was bad. So we read about human sacrifice in Ahaz. We didn't look at it, but after Ahaz came Hezekiah. Hezekiah was a good king. He cleaned stuff up. But right after Hezekiah, we're now in chapter 21, and 21 verses 1 to 9. After Hezekiah came Manasseh. He was 12. Oh, maybe that's the problem. When he became king, he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. Hezekiah tears him down. Manasseh comes to power. He builds him up. He erected altars for Baal and an Asherah, as Ahab, the king of Israel, had done. Worshipped all the hosts of heaven and served them. He worshipped stars. Built altars. Verse 4. Where did he build the altar? In whose temple? That Solomon built. That beautiful temple that Solomon had everyone come out and consecrated it. God's glory came down and rested on it. In that temple, Manasseh built altars to his idols. And I like how God has us remember the house where God said, in Jerusalem I will put my name. He put altars for all the hosts of heaven in the two courts. Someone mentioned, yes, there were rooms. And you're going to start reading about rooms that were overtaken by idols. He made his son pass through the fire, like Ahaz had. Practiced witchcraft, divination, dealt with mediums and spiritists. He did much evil. He provoked God to anger. He set a carved image of Asherah that he had made in the house, in the temple. Anyways, verse 9, it says, God sent people to say, hey, don't do that. They did not listen. Manasseh seduced them to do evil more than the nations whom the Lord destroyed before the sons of Israel. So, do you see the progression?
He had more time, right? So we had Manasseh's granddad sacrifice his son and do some idol worship. We had good. Then we had Manasseh rebuild all the bad and like pile that on top. It just is getting progressively worse. Go to 2 Kings 20.
And in steps our hero, who is Josiah.
Josiah finds the law. Josiah tears it down. Josiah 23 has all the details
of all the things. I mean, he not only tore it down, he ground it up in verse 6, in 2 Kings 23:6. He brought the Asherah out that Manasseh put in there. He burned it. He ground it to dust. He threw its dust on the graves of the common people. I think he made a statement. 7, he broke down the houses of the male cult prostitutes, which were where? There were prostitutes in the temple. He broke them down where the women were weaving hangings in the house of the Lord. Women were weaving hangings for idols. He brought all the priests that defiled it, and anyway, he took care of them. Verse 10. Here we go, Topheth. He also defiled, so this is Josiah. So Topheth they made holy to their idols. So when you read that Josiah defiled it, well, because he didn't honor it, he didn't say it's holy to idols. So Josiah defiled Topheth, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, that no man might make his son or his daughter pass through the fire for Moloch. He did away with the horses that were given to the sun gods, right? Let's see, verse 12, the altars which were on the roof, the upper chamber, he took it all down. But you see mention of Topheth there. Go back to Jeremiah. Topheth, that's what we're going to hit. So go back to Jeremiah 7. So let's do this. Jeremiah 7, 31. Let's remind ourselves. What was going on in Topheth? What have you just read? A little bit. What was going on there? Human sacrifices. So Topheth, Manasseh, probably also Ahaz before him, took an area not so far from Jerusalem and dedicated it to idol worship, including human sacrifice. What I read is it's a valley. It's a valley. So you read that it is Topheth, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom. Now, this is interesting. God says they rebuilt it, right? Manasseh did it. Josiah got rid of it, but there's memory of it in the conscious of these people, right? The people of Judah know what was going on there, even though Josiah stopped it. And he says, days are coming, verse 32, when it will no longer be called Topheth or the Valley of the Son of Hinnom, but it's going to be called the Valley of the what? For they will bury in Topheth because there's no other place. Okay, hold on there a minute. The other thing I read about this area. Yeah, so God said it's no longer going to be for idol worship. God's going to say, no, that's not going to happen anymore. Instead, it's going to be a place where dead bodies are brought. What is God prophesying? What's Jeremiah prophesying is going to happen to Jerusalem? The armies are going to come wipe them out. It's a picture of when that judgment happens, there are going to be so many dead people. And I hate to bring it up, but in my consciousness, you know, not so long ago, we saw pictures in India. So many people died. You can't take care of the bodies in the right way, so you bring them all to the valley, and they pile up. Now, those of you that like a little bit of Revelation, Topheth is from the Hebrew word for fireplace. It rhymes with the Hebrew word for shame. That's interesting. The Valley of Hinnom, I didn't dive deep enough, but it is the idea of New Testament Gehenna. So in the New Testament, Gehenna was a valley outside of Jerusalem that was where they took all the refuse from the city, the trash, and they burned it. And it burned day and night. There was constantly smoke coming up. In Revelation, we're told about battles that are fought there, right? So it's like always in God's Bible, the idea of, you know, this place where they thought they were worshiping idols, and God's actually saying it's actually a gross and disgusting place. It's a place of destruction. It's a place of bloodshed. It's a place where the fire always burns. At the end of Revelation, those that refuse to accept God, what is their eternal destiny? Lake of fire. It's that picture. So you see a picture of that lake of fire, I think, in Topheth. It's not the same, but it's a picture of, it's a foreshadowing. It's God saying there's judgment. And how interesting is it, in this place where they committed those sins is then the place where this judgment's going to happen. There's going to be so many dead people that they're just going to pile up in this city. So I think that's what's going on there. Does that make sense? I like that point too, Crystal. His message hasn't changed. It's still sin must be judged. And the wages of sin is always death. Is there provision? Is there forgiveness so one doesn't have to experience death? Always, even in the Old Testament. Turn back to me. You don't have to go through this. But God is really clear. But if you do, this is your destiny. It's slaughter. It's death. So verse 33 and 34 are pretty graphic. And God basically says, that day, when the Babylonians come on you, dead people, they're going to be food for birds. Why? Because there's so many, you can't bury them. That is extremely, extremely offensive to Hebrew mentality, the idea of not immediately burying a dead person. Well, I think for all of us, it's a distressing, offensive picture, but for them in particular. And he says 30, 34, I will make the feast in the cities of Judah and from the streets of Jerusalem, the voice of joy, the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, the voice of the bride, for the land will become a... And this message was declared where? At the gates of the temple, where gladness was always heard, right? Where they were always singing, where they were always having a festival, and everything is great, and our God loves us, and look how beautiful that is. Thanksgiving, right? Right? All of that. And God's like, actually, your behavior behind closed doors, in the privacy of your home, worshiping the idols in those secret rooms, the prostitution, the harlotry, the not helping those that need help because you want more money in your pocket, the lying to your neighbor, all of that. God's like, I see it, and it leads to ruin. That's chapter 7. Yes, we spent a lot of time in chapter 7. I anticipated that. We'll breeze through 8 and 9. But chapter 7, what about a theme for it? I think you have to have something about the temple because that is the location of this message. So what is he saying about the temple? You could put that in your theme. I like that, Rachel. Sad days coming. Destruction coming. What about the temple? What's the short message about the temple? He's preaching at them. You could say that. Preaching at the temple. Degradation of the temple. Don't trust in the temple, maybe. Something like that. Don't trust in the temple. Deception was a big theme in there, so you might have something about deceptive words. And then I put Valley of Slaughter, because it's a pretty significant image that God has there. Or maybe you put Topheth, and that's fine too, but maybe something about the temple, not trusting in it, deceptive words, and the judgment to come. So was that a pleasant chapter? No. And so this is when Denise goes, why is God saying this over and over and over? And we'll visit that question soon. Because chapter 8 sounds a lot like chapter 7, right? Chapter 8, okay. I'm going to read chapter 1, verse 1. No, I'm going to read 1 to 3. And so think, does this connect to chapter 7? Do you hear it as a continuation, or in your mind is it a separate thing? So 8 verses 1 to 3. At that time, declares the Lord. So you go, what time? They will bring out the bones of the kings of Judah, the bones of its princes, the bones of the priests, the bones of the prophets, the bones of the inhabitants of Jerusalem from their graves. They will spread them out to the sun, the moon, to the host of heaven, which they have loved, which they have served, which they have gone after, which they have sought, which they have worshipped. They will not be gathered or buried. They will be as dung on the face of the ground. And death will be chosen rather than life by all the remnant that remains of this evil family, that remains in all the places to which I've driven them, declares the Lord of hosts. Is this a continuation of 7, or do you think this is a brand new message? It's a continuation. I read nothing that says, you know, in the time of so-and-so, now go declare this. And especially starting with the phrase, at that time. So at that time is what time, do you think? Babylon, I think verses 34, right? I think it's 7, 33, and 34. When there is such slaughter that you can't even bury the people, when that utter ruin comes on Jerusalem and Judah, at that time, people are going to do what? This is weird, but it's, what are people doing? All this death has happened, and they're going and they're bringing what out? They are exhuming people. What kind of people are getting exhumed? Leaders. And then they're doing what with the bones? Why? Can you figure out why? Like, what's your sense for the why? Why are they doing this? It's a visual, right? Okay, so are they doing it saying, like, have mercy, everyone's already dead, maybe? Yeah, just like we've been utterly destroyed. I think we are on the right track. Dead bodies and bones will not be buried. So it's the idea that when all the bones and bodies are not being buried, even the bones of the wicked are going to be disgraced. Because remember, God has said your king, your prophet, your priest have deceived you. So when that judgment comes, it's like a second judgment on them. Not only are they killed, they're not even allowed to be buried. No. It is dark. Because those people are always going to let down, right? And so don't you think that the Israelites have also, they put their faith in the temple, that they put their faith in their king, they put their faith in the priest, they put their faith in false prophets, and those people are going to utterly let them down. They're gonna actually experience double disgrace. What I also read in the commentary is, to bring those bones out and to spread them on the ground is the highest expression of hatred and contempt. What does God think of our leaders who mislead his people? What do you know about that even, huh? To whom much is given, much is expected. There's an extra level. I mean, I'm not saying we're going to experience Dante's level of hell. But, I mean, some people say there might be something like that, but I do read from Jesus, from God, even here, this thing of those that have misled his people spiritually and, like, led them, Ahaz, Manasseh, others before them, led them in paths of destruction and evil, there's an extra bit of judgment for them. And I think that's what you see here. Interesting verse 3. Death will be chosen rather than life by even the ones that are left behind. Like even that happening, I just see a little bit like even that happening, these people are so far gone that that's not going to turn them. I mean, how sad is that? So, moving on. Yeah, that's nice and dark, isn't it? Verses 4 to 12. There's a lot of repetition, I think, in verses 4 to 12 of what we have read before. So, interesting that God said, I kind of thought these verses were poetic and interesting. Verse 4, God says, you know, say to the people, don't men fall and get up? Don't people turn away and then repent? He's like, but these people refuse to return. He's like, even in battle, people turn. He says, even the seasons, know the seasons, the birds go one way for one season and then they return. He's like, look at nature. People come back, except his people. Are they returning? No. He's like, everyone else turns, but my very own people refuse to turn. It does sound really hopeless. Verse 8, then he talks about wisdom. He says, how can you say you're wise and God's law is in you? Verse 9, the wise are put to shame. Why? Because they've rejected God's word. So what kind of wisdom do they have? And he kind of talks about their future, you know, that they're going to lose everything. 11's interesting. Jeremiah 8:11, they heal the brokenness of the daughter of my people. How? Because they said, peace, peace, but there's no peace. So those leaders, there was some healing, but it was superficial. Whew, this sounds dark. It is dark. Why do you think, let's stop here just for a minute. Why this repetition? If you're like me, I get a little frustrated with it. Like, I've heard this. Why are we saying it again? Is every repetition another chance? That's a good question. Is every repetition another chance? Yes. And this is what Jeremiah is supposed to say. Yes. There's a certainty in it for Jeremiah. Do you and I need repetition? Do we hate it? I feel like we hate it. I feel like we are a people that are like, seen it, done it, don't do it again. Generally speaking, we don't like to hear things more than once. We do tend to forget them, but we really don't like, I mean, how about this? I don't have to be told more than once. I remember you said that. You don't have to tell me again. Don't tell me again. I'm not dumb. I don't need to hear it again. I mean, that's what we think. Okay, so yes, you and Rachel are together on this, and I agree. So Jeremiah needs the repetition because he's going to be hit with adversity. Because the people are going to, he already has been hit. His sanity is going to be questioned. He's going to be told to shut up. People are going to come against him. So he needs to hear it over and over to be sure, right? The people, he is, yes. It appears so. Mm-hmm. He's like Noah. I mean, wrap your mind around that. Noah was the only righteous man at that time. It appears that Jeremiah is the only righteous man, and he needs to be sure of his message. So I think some of it is God's grace to Jeremiah to hear it again and again. Yes, I think it's also repetition for his people, because while we say, I don't think I need to hear it more than once, we do. We forget. We need to be warned many times. Has anyone gotten one speeding ticket and never sped again? I wait about a week, right? Do we wait like a week? Maybe some of us wait like 24 hours, I don't know. Or you go on that deferred adjudication, and in that case, you have to wait for what, like 6 months? But not that I've ever done that. But we are offended by the idea of being reminded of things, and yet we desperately need it. I think in the church, that's a personal thing. I think in the church, like being in the church for a long time, I have to fight against that. You know, oh, they've already preached on that. Why are they preaching on that again? Preach on something new. Tell me something I haven't heard before. But the gospel's the gospel. It's a simple message we need to hear over and over. The idea that God judges sin. We have to hear it. I mean, anyway, kind of challenged by that personally. So, let's see, the destruction, we've heard that. Let's see, in light of time, let's see, what do we need to, let's go down to verse 18. Skipping. Who did you mark as speaking in verse 18? Yeah, there's no quotation marks. I think Jeremiah's also, and it differs, but I think from 14 to 16 could very well be Jeremiah's voice as well. But I want to kind of focus here on verse 18, because what effect does this repetition of coming judgment have on Jeremiah? We're just feeling a little bit of it. He says, my sorrow is beyond healing. My heart is faint. Verse 19, it's kind of like a prophetic thing. He's like, I can hear, you know, my people in that judgment going, where is God? Verse 20, he says, harvest past, summer is ended, we are not saved. He's kind of, verse 22, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then has not the health of the daughter of my people been restored? What do you see the cry of Jeremiah's heart being right here? Jeremiah holding, I like to call it, an in-between place. Like, he knows there's judgment. Remember Jeremiah when he heard his words and he's like, hey God, I think you're misleading the people. He's not saying that anymore. He's like, God, I know that judgment is coming and it's destroying my heart. It's making me sad, but I like Rachel's point, but he still knows these are his covenant people. And he's never going to completely, and God has said already, it's not complete destruction, it's right up to the edge of it. And I see Jeremiah going, when's that healing going to happen? I know this judgment's going to happen, but how is the healing going to happen, God? I think it's hard for him to see, right? He's saying it's hard for me to see it, but where is it? I love this, and again, in Emotionally Healthy Spirituality and Relationship that John and I are teaching, it's amazing. These past 2 weeks have been on feelings, and I'm reading this, and I'm like, Jeremiah is having some really strong feelings. He is grieving. He is distressed. He is hurting. I think his stomach, I think it's having a physical toll on his body. He references crying. In chapter 9, he says, I just want to run away, right? So I love that he's feeling all of it, and at the same time, I think he's also feeling that little bit of hope. Like, God, I know that there is a future of salvation. It's hard for me to see because these hard feelings are real, but I know that it's out there too. I see a lot of that. Okay, let's do, yes. Yeah, okay, that's a good thing. The daughter of my people, the cry of the daughter of my, okay, this is Denise, because when I was buzzing through it, I just, Judah, like the inhabitants of Judah, because they have a cry, right? They have a voice. They're broken. Their health is destroyed. Maybe it's also a reference to, like, the daughters of my people, even the next generation that's coming. So those that are here in Judah now and those that are coming from that next generation. God calls Israel his bride. So this is Jeremiah's words, and he's saying the daughter of my people. So, my best guess would be that generation and then the one right after them. But they're going to suffer. They're going to suffer. That's my guess. Okay, 9. Let's continue on, because I want to have some time to spend at the end of 9, because I think that's where some good stuff finally hits. Okay, 9:1-2. So we have these words. Oh, that my head were waters and my eyes a fountain of tears, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. There it is again, Patsy. Oh, that I had in the desert. Oh, he's like, I wish I had a lake house, a wayfarer's lodging place, that I might leave my people and go from them. For all of them are adulterers, an assembly of treacherous men. They bend their tongues like their bow, lies, and not truth prevails. Okay, who's speaking here? I have it as Jeremiah. What's Jeremiah wanting to do? What I would want to do when there's really bad news. He wants to go. Huh? Go on vacation. I want to run. He doesn't want to necessarily go to a great place either. He's not asking for the beach. He's just like, give me a house in the desert. Why does he want to go there? I think his eyes have been opened to just how evil it is. And he's like, how can I even stand it here? You ever felt that way? You ever had your eyes open to such evil in a system, among a group of people, in a place that you're like, I want to go? That's me about after a day and a half in Vegas. I need to go. Yes, that's beautiful architecture and the meals are fabulous, but if I see another hint of prostitution, gambling, drug use, like, I just gotta go. It feels gross. I can't, yeah. I love his feelings that he's talking, he is saying this to God. He's taking all that yuck, to God. I'm personally challenged by that. I don't do that enough in my relationship with God, like take my yuck right to him. Okay, lots about deceit in verses 3-9, right? And God's basically saying, these people are deceptive. Let's see, verse 6. God says, through deceit, they refuse to know me. Verse 7, therefore, says God, I will refine them and assay them. What else can I do because of the daughter of my people? Their tongue is a deadly arrow. It speaks deceit. With his mouth, he speaks peace to his neighbor, but inwardly, he sets an ambush for them. What's he saying about the people? How are they deceptive? Their mouths are saying what? What do the people do to saying with their mouths? Peace. Even while they go to the temple, we love God. Even to their neighbor, I love you, I'll take care of you. But what are they actually doing? They speak deceit because actually they're lying, they're harming one another, they're not worshiping God. So God's saying any word coming out of their mouth is a lie. And so I have to ask myself, as the church, do we speak lies when we come and say, we love you, God, we're going to serve you, but then we don't, or act contrary? Yeah, I think it's a similar thing. So God says he has to judge them. Again, we just have that repeated idea over and over and over again, and I'm trying to get to 17. Again, this is all all one message, right? I'm getting to 17. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider and call for the mourning women that they may come. Send for the wailing women that they may come. Let them make haste. Take up a wailing for us that our eyes may shed tears, our eyelids flow with water, for a voice of wailing is heard from Zion. So God says, go call who? The professional mourners. Back in those days, they had the professional mourners, right? You saw them on the doorstep. Remember when Jesus came to Lazarus' house? There were professional mourners there. They came out in haste. Someone died, you called them. They showed up. They were on the doorstep. They were in their best black. They were really good at crying on cue. And they wailed. And they cried. And you knew someone was important because they had a lot of those people. And if you didn't have a lot of those, then you were a common man or no one important. So God is saying, call them. Why? A death is getting ready to happen. Who's getting ready to die? The wages of sin is death. Who's getting ready to die? Judah, right? So it's the same idea again, but God's like, so call the mourners. It's not that far away, because why? They're going to be put out of their land. Okay, death, verse 21, death has come through our windows to cut off children from the street, young men from the squares. The corpse of men will fall like dung on the open field. Okay, God, it's really, really clear, right? So 23 and 24, whew, finally made it. We're going to talk just for a moment about these great verses, 23 and 24. Thus says the Lord, let not a wise man boast of his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast of his might. Let not a rich man boast of his riches. But let him who boasts, boast of this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who exercises loving kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth, for I delight in these things. Boast, another word for boast here is also glory. And God has a couple things that
one can boast of or have put glory in. Glory is like naming a thing and being like, that's the thing that makes my world.
The glory in something is to say, this thing makes me happy, this thing makes me proud, this thing makes my world go round, I'm going to invest everything in this thing. If you're glorying in something, it is a similar idea to boast. But God says there are three things in verse 33 that wise men, mighty men, that
men in general boast in. I think it still holds true today. What are those three things in verse 23? Wisdom.
Wisdom, power, money.
Wisdom. So the wise men boast in wisdom. Mighty men, might or power, right? And what's the last one?
Riches.
Okay, he says, don't boast in those things.
Wait a minute, are those things bad inherently? I think of Solomon, so interesting to me, this is me I was thinking about the temple. Solomon built that temple. Solomon was all of these three things, right? When Solomon was on the earth, he was the wisest. He had a ton of money, right? And he conquered all his enemies. Not bad things. In fact, God gave those things to him, right? But God, I see God saying, but shift, he's like, hey people, shift your mindset toward the things, right, that God
glories in. And what are those three things in 24? God says, I exercise what? Loving kindness. Justice and, what was that, righteousness?
Honor.
Yeah, I'm going to use righteousness here. Yeah, that these things can happen on earth too, right? These things can happen on earth. These things can happen on earth. These things fade, right?
These things are concrete. But the thing is, God is speaking through Jeremiah on the steps of the temple that Solomon built, who was wise, who was rich, who was powerful. And that temple is getting ready to be demolished. And I see God saying, these things fade, can go away. These things never fade, never go away. These are eternal. God is all of these things perfectly, right? His loving kindness is seen in his covenant with the people. His justice is seen in God's perfect determination of what is evil and what is good. We're seeing that all through Jeremiah. God's like, that's evil, that's good. I see it all. And righteousness, his standard for what is good and what is right. And God is making a promise, right? And he's saying, let those who boast, boast of this, that he understands and knows me. We didn't have enough time because we ran out of time. But I hope in chapter 9 you mark knowing God. Because knowing there is yada. It's not just like having an intellectual thing. Yada is like an intimate knowledge of something. And God's like, if you really know me, Israel, if you had really known me, you wouldn't be boasting in your beautiful temple. You would be boasting that you're taking care of one another, that you're doing the right thing, that you're following the law, that you're honoring me. But instead, Israel, you boast here, and this is going to go away. I think that's what 23 and 24 is. Rachel texted me late last night, and she's like, I finally found the hope. And I was like, it is. There's hope in those verses. Why did God drop that verse in there? What do you think is the hope in that verse? Go ahead. And it is going to. Yeah. And who provides all this stuff perfectly? Right. Right. It's the idea, I mean, Nivea just said, you know, we can do these things. Again, these things in and of themselves are not bad. They can be gifts from God to people. That temple, God designed it. He loved things of beauty. He wanted his people to be powerful and secure and to be wise. But when we boast in it, when we become like Judah going, nothing bad's going to happen because look at this great temple. Nothing bad's going to happen to us, America, or my church, or my neighborhood, or my house, because look at all the things I have. Nivea said, even in those things, we know they're fading. Like, even the joy they're giving us lasts, and then you're like, but now I need more. Right? Solomon's temple is great, but what if we made it bigger? Right? Like, Solomon had a lot of riches, but Solomon's problem was, he's like, but I love that woman, and I want that woman, too. I'm not happy with just my 12 wives. I need 100, or however many he had. That's our problem, and God is trying to point them. That's what I'm saying. He really is, He doesn't say this is bad. He says, but rather boast in these things. These are the things, because you're right, Nivea, they're eternal. Yeah. I think God intended that. For his, if he asked, can these things be put together? Yes, but this is the eternal, right? Yeah, boasting's an important word there, yeah. But anyway, so verse 25, we're ending with God's like, even though there's hope, and he's like, you guys, you know the right way. Look at me, look at my character, do the right way. But he still reminds them, behold, days are coming that I will punish these people. And he uses the picture of circumcision again and not circumcised. So that's the ending, because it's 4 minutes after 11, but it was three chapters. Mercy. Okay, so chapter 9, a theme for this. Oh, did we not talk about the theme for 8? We said was, oh, you're right. Well, yeah, okay, so I'll just give you what they gave me, because I messed up. I'll do it this way. 8 precepts said it was evil remnant will choose death. We didn't talk a lot about that, and I guess I don't have a problem with that. It's just kind of interesting. 11 is the evil remnant will choose death. That's straight from 8 verse 3, because it's the idea of the bones coming out, and that even those that are left behind are still going to choose death. 9 has a lot of the idea of weeping, and again, we touched on it, so weeping. And God will punish their deceit. I like the use of weeping and deceit, because deceit's all over the place in that chapter, and so is weeping. So weeping, dash, God will punish their deceit. That's what they had. If you had something different, that's fine. Their deceit, yeah. I know, I find coming up with these chapter themes really challenging. I know, it feels like they're all the same. So you're like, how can I make this one about punishment slightly different from that one about punishment? It's not easy. Okay, we buzzed through pretty quick, especially 8 and 9. Any questions, anything that you're just like, I...